sure you folks will know a lot of these little songs that we put together. So please feel free to sing along with me, and let's worship the Lord.
Amen. Thank you. my Lord, wonderful.
Yesterday, today, forever, that is the same.
About half the people left, and we're not empty, so pretty good. Another blessing today, there's three little babies here at church. Isn't that a blessing? I counted three. They may have been more. Anybody count more than that? That's exciting. I praise the Lord for that. That's a great blessing. Let's take our Bible and turn to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter number 19, and I want to read verses 1 through 10. And I want to share with you a message, wanting to see Jesus, wanting to see Jesus. Luke 19, verses 1 through 10. This is probably a real familiar story, especially if you've been raised in church, attended church when you were little. Begin reading in verse 1 of chapter 19, the Gospel of Luke. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was the chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press or the crowd of people that was around, because he was little of stature. He wasn't Brother John Williams' size. He was a little bit shorter than that. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to a place to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And I say something to you, Jesus loves sinners. Well, that's why he came to this earth, to save them. We'll see that in just a little bit. I'm glad he loves sinners. That means he loves me. Amen. Notice verse 8, and Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is the son of Abraham. He's not talking about his genealogy, he's talking about his faith, the same faith Abraham had. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we love you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for an opportunity this morning to stand up and tell others about Jesus, our wonderful Savior. And Lord, I pray you'd help every individual that's here in this service today. Lord, some may have walked to those doors having never met you. They don't know you. And they need to be saved. And we ask, God, that you would prick their heart. and that you would deal with them and help them, Holy Spirit, to come and give their life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, that they may leave this service walking with you and knowing you. Lord, being forgiven of their sins and having the assurance of eternal life through the Lord Jesus Christ. But also there are others, Father, that they have known you. They have walked with you. But Lord, they are not as close as what they ought to be. And I pray, Lord, that you'd use the word today to help them. Lord, to get their eyes back on the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord, encourage them, Lord, to recommit to be a faithful follower of Jesus. Lord, I pray you'd help those that are discouraged, that need encouragement. Lord, I pray you'd help those that are not walking close to you to get closer today. God, just bless in this service, accomplish your will and purpose. And Lord, we'll give you glory for what you do, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray and ask these things. Amen. As Jesus would travel through Galilee to Jerusalem, he often would go through Jericho. And yes, this is that same Jericho that you read about in the Old Testament where the walls came tumbling down in Joshua chapter 5 and verse 6. And this is the town. It doesn't look like that on this occasion, but it's the same area. And Jesus would often travel. In fact, if you'll go through the Gospels, you'll see where Jesus performed quite a few miracles here and accomplished great works. But here on this occasion, he has the opportunity to deal with a man by the name of Zacchaeus. And like I said, if you've gone to church when you were little and you've been raised in church, you probably learned a children's song about Zacchaeus. How many of you learned a children's song about Zacchaeus? All right, not everybody, but it goes something like this. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. And he climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and said, "Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today." And then it has, "I'm going to your house today." And so it's a common story among people that have attended church or gone to children's church. I would doubt if they don't sing it today. So if you have kids out there, you ask them about it when they get home. They might say yes. Yep, we sung about Zacchaeus. So it's a very familiar story about a man who heard about Jesus. He's interested in Jesus. And he wants to see Jesus. He wants to see if what I've heard about Jesus, is that true? What can I learn about the Son of God, or this miracle worker, or the man that's called Jesus Christ? We're told a little bit about Zacchaeus' background and his life. We're told that he wasn't a tall man. We're told that he was rich. We're told that he was a tax collector. By the way, we're getting a few more of those, from what I understand, in America. So make sure you're keeping your taxes just right. And not only was he a tax collector, but he was the leading tax collector in Jericho. And a little bit later on, there's an indication that maybe he was a thief as well. He took things that did not really belong to him. And so I want to talk to you this morning about wanting to see Jesus. And the first thing I want to mention to you are the obstacles to seeing Jesus. There are some things that will get in your way. Now, most likely, you're not going to see Jesus with a physical eye. I say most likely because if you're alive, when the Lord comes back, we'll see him in the air. Amen? But I doubt that you're going to see the physical, literal body of Christ in this world. I'm not trying to get you to look for that kind of experience. But what I do want to encourage you to look for is for Christ. You might not see him with your physical eye, but you can see him clearly in a spiritual sense. Amen? He will make himself known. He will appear to you, not in a physical sense again, but he will appear, make himself known to you. Jesus, by the way, promised this. If you have your Bibles, you might want to look at John 14:21. It's a great little passage. And there's a condition that's laid out in that passage in order for us to see the presence of Jesus, or for Christ to make himself known or manifest himself in our lives. And this is that requirement in verse 21 of John 14. It says, "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me." We obey him because we love him. We don't obey him because our obedience guarantees us a ticket to heaven. The only guaranteed ticket to heaven is putting our faith and trust in Jesus. That's the only way that you and I are going to make it into heaven, is by accepting what Christ done on the cross when he took your sin and my sin, and John writes, the sin of the world, upon his own shoulders, walked up Calvary's hill, laid down on a cruel cross, suffered, bled, and died one Friday, hanging on that cross for 6 long hours, being crucified, dying for your sins. And so all your sins have been paid for in the blood of Christ. Amen? They took the lifeless body of Jesus off the cross, buried it in a borrowed tomb. Early one Sunday morning, Christ walks out of that tomb alive forevermore. Your sin debt having been taken care of. He paid for it. It's finished. Now all that's lacking is you putting your faith and trust in him.
Amen.
Say, "Lord, the only hope that I have of getting to heaven is what Jesus did on the cross.
Amen.
And I accept that as the payment for my sin debt. And I believe on him." So it says in verse 21 of John 14, "He it is that loveth me," and notice it says, "And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father." Notice this also, "And I will love him and will manifest myself to him." Jesus said, if you obey me, and you're obeying me because you love me, my Father will love you, I will love you, and I will show myself or reveal myself or manifest myself to you. Isn't that good news? By the way, that is a concrete promise that we all have from Christ. Amen? Not just for the apostles after the resurrection to see Jesus, but for those who love him and demonstrate that love by obeying him. Our goal as Christians is to get closer and closer to Jesus. I hope none of you are satisfied with how close you are to Jesus. And sometimes we forget, even as Christians, well, how can I draw close to God? How can I get closer to Jesus? How can I see Jesus? And I want to remind you of a little passage in Colossians chapter 2 and verse 16. It says this, "As ye therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him." He said, you live the Christian life the same way you came to Christ and were saved in the first place.
Amen.
You hear what the Bible teaches, then you believe that, and by faith you accept that, and if you'll do that, you can have salvation. By the way, every other step you take as a Christian is taken on that same basis. I've learned something from the Word of God, I believe that's true, and I'm going to trust God to work that out in my life so that he gets the glory. So think about it. What hinders us from seeing Jesus? It's certainly not that Christ is hiding himself. Amen? He wants to be seen by you. He wants you to know him. He's not trying to keep you at a distance. I promise you that. What his heart's desire is, above everything, is that you have an intimate, personal relationship with him. Amen? You say, "Preacher, how do I know that?" Well, the cross settles that. Amen? If he would come and die on a cross, nothing else can prove more than that, that he loves you and he wants to have a right relationship with you. Amen? So what are some things that get in the way? Well, for Zacchaeus, it might have been his position. Notice he's called chief among the publicans. There's something about getting close to Jesus that we all have to face. This world ridicules those who want to get close to Jesus. the world thinks if you're going to get closer and closer and closer to Christ. A lot of times in a high position, a leader among the tax collectors, we have a tendency maybe to say, well, what would my friends think? Or what would these co-workers think? I mean, here they go out and make a lot of money, and now I'm coming in, I'm talking about Jesus, and I just don't think the world's going to accept that. Can I say something to you? The world will never accept that. Have you ever done this? You try to read maybe a different version and see what chief means? I'm not talking about, Native Americans. I thought it's interesting. A lot of times this happens when you try to read a different version because they're supposed to make it so much easier. You know what every version uses? It uses the word chief. It simply means he was the leader or head. All the other tax collectors were looking to him. And when the world is doing that, we don't want to be ridiculed and mocked. And so a lot of times, instead of us being completely yielded to Christ, we try to divide up our Christian life. We don't mind being a Christian in our prayer closet or a Christian at home, but as soon as we get in the car to go to work, we really don't want to make too many people know that we are a follower of Christ. You know what Jesus called that? He called that being ashamed of Him. You know what else He called that? He called that hiding your light under a bushel. And when that light is hid, you can't help anyone else. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 26, he's talking about the difficulty of men who have high positions to come and humble themselves before Christ and be a genuine follower of Christ. He said, you've noticed this? For you see your calling, brethren, have there not many wise men, listen, after the flesh? Aren't you glad he added that, after the flesh? There's a lot of godly people that are very wise, brilliant. But he said, when men of this world, those that think they're really bright, you don't see many of them following Jesus. And he goes on to say, wise men after the flesh, not many mighty or many noble are called. He said, people in high positions, when I deal with them, they don't come running. Why? Because they're afraid of what people might say about them. They don't want to be ridiculed and mocked and laughed at. James, in his little epistle, the book of James towards the end of your Bible, says that if we're going to be a friend of the world, that means we're going to be God's enemy. In fact, he says something hard to hear. He said, if you're going to be friendly with the world and act like you don't know me, he said, that's spiritual adultery.
That's right.
It'd be just like a husband being unfaithful to his wife. How heartbreaking is that? Or a wife who would betray her husband. How heartbreaking is that? But Jesus said, if you're going to flirt with the world and love the world, that's exactly how you're treating me. Amen? So sometimes your position in life keeps you from coming and seeing Jesus like you ought to see Jesus. Amen? But secondly, his possessions. The Bible makes it clear that he was rich. You say, preacher, that shouldn't be a problem. Well, it shouldn't be a problem, but often it is a problem. I thank you for that amen. I appreciate that. You let him go because I don't get too many amens. Take it wherever I get it. But we ought to see where it is a problem, because Jesus said it's really hard for rich men to get into a right relationship with God. Why? Because they love possession. You know how hard Jesus said it was? He said it's hard as a camel going through the eye of a needle. And when the disciples heard that, they said, Lord, who then can be saved? I mean, if it's that hard for rich men to get saved, I mean, it must be hard for other people to get saved too. So, I mean, who could be saved? Jesus said, with men it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. Amen?
Amen.
You know why possessions sometimes keep us from following Christ? Because there's a fine line there. We're all called to work and labor. And by the way, work is not a curse word. It's great to be able to work. It's a joy to work. In fact, some satisfaction in life don't come but through hard work, accomplishing something. What a blessing that is. Amen? And so we're taught and instructed and commanded to work. Remember, Paul wrote to Ephesians, the Ephesian church at Ephesus, and he said this in chapter 4, verse 28. He said, "Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good." So even when it comes to work, don't use these hands. These things are evil. Amen? "Why? That he may have to give to him that needs." And on the Bible challenges. In fact, Paul wrote to the church, our young preacher Timothy, and he said, "Timothy, if people are unwilling to take care of their family, they've got a major spiritual problem." Now remember, in 1 Timothy 5, he said that we are to take care of widows. Who are widows indeed. That is, they don't have a husband. Husband's died. They don't have any close relatives. Their children have died. And the church is to take on that responsibility of caring for widows. If they don't have any family to help them, the church is to bear that burden. But then Paul also goes on to say, "But if there's a man that's unwilling to provide for his own family," let's say dad's died, mom's left alone, and here's a son, and he said, "Well, look, I'm not going to take care of you. I mean, go talk to Uncle Sam. Don't look at me." You know what the Bible says about a man like that? It said, "If he will not provide for his own, especially those of his own house, he hath denied the faith." Isn't that a strong statement? He's denied the faith and is worse than an infidel or an unbeliever. I think God puts a high stress on working and taking care of your family. Amen? When Paul wrote to the Thessalonians that Jesus was about to return, some of them quit working. They said, "Great, we don't have to do nothing else. We'll wait till Jesus comes back." And then Paul had to write a second Thessalonians. And he says this in 2 Thessalonians 3:10, "For even when we were with you, this we commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat." Now, you know, sometimes that's easy to read out or quote in church, but it's hard sometimes to put that in practice. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been there? I mean, here's a family that's suffering. They say to you, "Look, you're our only hope, our only resource. We're going to go without food unless you help us." And then you still realize, "I can't help you because you're never going to learn a lesson about taking care of yourself unless you start learning it now." Amen? And by the way, that's what the Bible teaches. It doesn't say he could not work. It says he would not work. Amen?
Amen?
And so I'm saying about possession, there's a fine line here. Why? Because we're instructed to work. We're instructed to make resources to take care of our family. If we don't take care of our family, worse than unbelievers. We've even denied the faith. But it's so easy to cross the line from working and start to make it worship. When work becomes your higher priority, and making money becomes the reason for you getting up in the morning and eagerly walking out the door, you start to cross the line when you start putting work before Jesus. Amen? Now this might help you. I hope it does. I really hope it does. I don't know that I mentioned it enough. When we used to have a young stage full of young kids that get up here and sing and worship God, and it was amazing. It was impressive. And then they got old enough and they started getting jobs. And then they started working on Sunday. And now they're no longer up here. It's so easy to go from, I need to get a job, I need to pay for my car, I need to do insurance, I've got to buy groceries, so all of a sudden, that's all life's about. And that's not what life is all about. It's a part of it, but it's not the main thing, amen? And you've got to be real careful that you don't become overly invested. I'm saying to you, you're never going to see Jesus like you need to see Jesus, even like you want to see Jesus, if you let the desire for money and other things interfere with your time with Christ. Amen? And so be careful about possessions. They can easily turn your heart away from the Lord. And Zacchaeus had to deal with that, and thank God he did. But notice also, because of the press. Now, that's talking about the crowd. Remember, we read that in chapter 19. He was short of stature. And verse 3 says, and he sought to see Jesus, who he was. He could not for the press or the crowd, because he was a smaller man. Now listen to me. You're smaller. There's a crowd that's gathered. What are you seeing when you're trying to see Jesus and there's a crowd and you're smaller? What are you seeing? You're seeing others. You're seeing others. You know why some people are not close to Jesus? Because they've got their eyes fixed on other people. They don't notice there's a tree right over there. I just climb up that tree and I get above everybody else and I can see the one I'm looking for. They just keep looking at others. Let me tell you something. You'll never see Jesus as long as you're looking at other people. There's only been one perfect individual that ever walked on the face of the earth. By the way, not two. Only one, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only one that never sinned in anything he ever did. Not in thought, word, or in his deed or conduct. Never sinned one single time, and he is the only one who's ever lived perfect righteousness in this earth. All of us, everybody else, that's all of us, we've come far short of that. When you get your eyes on people, let me tell you something, you're going to be discouraged. And you're going to get your eyes off of Jesus, and you'll get your eyes off Jesus real fast.
Right.
In Isaiah chapter 6, some Bible commentaries point this out, that Isaiah the prophet was called to be a prophet. He had a right relationship with God, but he never knew God like he needed to know God until the one he had his eyes fixed on passed away. In Isaiah chapter 6, it says, In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up upon his throne, and his train filled the temple.
All right.
And I saw angels cry, holy, holy, holy. It wasn't until the king got out of his vision that he could really see Jesus for who he was. I want to just warn you about something. If you're not close to Christ, it could be that you're looking at other people. You know, one of the common things we hear as we try to go out door knocking and talk to people is, I once went to church, hear me now, I once went to church and Pastor so-and-so did such and such. Now that's a shame. That's heartbreaking. It should never happen. But it does happen. And if that pastor made any mistake, worse than whatever it was that offended you, was that he did not point you to Jesus as often as he should have pointed you to Jesus. And he should have said something like this, I am frail, I am weak, I may completely disappoint you. But let me tell you something. Jesus never will.
Amen.
Amen? I know what it means to have confidence in a godly person. and to continue to hope that they do well spiritually. But the only one that will never let you down is the Lord Jesus Christ. Me and Brother Henry yesterday was talking to this gentleman named Bob. And I said, "Mr. Bob, do you attend church?" He said, "No, I don't attend church." He said, "When my kids were young," he said, "I took them to church and raised them up in church. They accepted Christ. They're still going to church, so I figured I've done my job. They're in church, they have their relationship with Christ, so I figured I've done my job." And I said, "Mr. Bob, let me tell you something. Those kids are still watching you. They're still expecting you to be an example. They're still looking to you. Guess what? I used to think once you get the kids grown and they're out of the house, job's over." Nope. It's never over. Amen? You're always going to either be pointing men to Jesus or away from Jesus. You get your eyes on a pastor, I guarantee you, pastors will fail you. By the way, I believe they're Satan's number one targets. A gentleman sat down beside a fellow on the plane. They were passing out meals. And the guy said, "No, thank you, I'm fasting." The man said, "Oh, that's interesting. You must be a Christian." He said, "Oh, so you're a Christian?" He said, "No." He said, "Why are you fasting?" He said, I'm a part of the Church of Satan. And we've set aside this month the fact that pastors all across America will fall into immorality and sin. That's what the opposing side is doing. They're pleading with the devil to cause pastors to crumble and fail. And I say something to you, on our side, there are probably few that are bending knees saying, "God, please help us not to fail." Get your eyes off of pastors. Get them on Jesus. Even parents. It breaks my heart sometimes. I hear about parents who take their kids to church and all of a sudden they've gotten to gross immorality. And the first thing I think of is, what about the kids? It may be your partner. And when I say partner, I'm not talking about living in a house with someone that's not your husband or wife. That's still immoral. It's still wrong. And when I say partner, I'm not talking about being married to two men being married or two women being married. When I say partner, because I'm saying parents and preachers, I want to say husband or wife, if you're not careful, even they will get your eyes off Jesus. Isn't that right? I mean, you can get so wrapped up in overly being concerned about one aspect or another that it turns your gaze away from Christ. And you don't ever need to turn your gaze away from Christ. You'll always need Jesus. Amen? And so many other things that could be lumped underneath the crowd or the group of people that were gathered that day. Let me give you one last thing. It's personal conflict. His personal conflict. You know his name, Zacchaeus, his name. You know what his name means? It means purity. Now, just because you give a child a name, it doesn't mean he's going to live that way. Amen? Or everyone named Jesus, they would never do anything wrong. Is that right? Amen? But you know there's a personal conflict here. His name is purity, and what is he doing? He's going out, like most tax collectors, and you owe $50, and he's saying Rome is required, taxes have gone up, you've got to pay 60 this year, and gives Rome the 50, and he puts 10 in his pocket. Okay. And that's how most of them got wealthy. By robbing their fellow citizens that were underneath an oppressing power that day. So here's Mr. Purity going out and doing the impure thing. He had some conflicts on the inside. How many many times do you think Jesus passed through the same area? He passed through quite a bit. It was only this day that he said, listen, I want to see whatever this Jesus stuff's all about. He had many opportunities prior to this, wouldn't you think? Amen? But something had been keeping him away from Jesus, and it may have been him facing his own failures and weaknesses and saying, certainly Jesus wouldn't want somebody like me. Personal conflict. Sometimes our own character keeps us from getting closer to Christ. I don't know why, but recently I've watched some court TV. Anybody else watch court TV?
Amen.
About three of you. Thank God for you folks here. And I'm not really interested in the judges or the attorneys. I'm interested in the one that's standing before the judge, and he's on trial. And listen, you know what they do? They take a simple problem, and they make it worse and worse and worse. All they got to do is be quiet. All they got to say nothing. Just don't say anything. And they can't do it. Why? Because some stuff in here is not right. I watched one. And the attorney said, I can no longer represent my client. And the judge said, well, you're going to have to. He said, you don't understand, I can't represent it. I have a conflict of interest. And he said, well, I don't see what the conflict is. She said, look, I've done this, the conflict is, I cannot represent it. So the client speaks up. Judge didn't ask his opinion. He just speaks up and says some words he shouldn't have said. But basically, you idiot, she's told you three times. So you know what the judge does? He said, case over, no bail, go back to jail. They said, judge, wait, wait. He said, no, I'm not waiting for anything. It's over. Go back to the jail. And I thought if he could have just held out a little bit longer and been quiet, the judge might have showed him a little bit of favor, seeing he was in some bad situations. His attorney didn't want to be there, right? One got out there and said, I have my attorney here, but I'm going to do all the talking. And the judge said, now, wait a minute. Now, she's been to law school. She's been before me. She's brilliant. She knows how to offer an argument. You don't know how to. Yeah, the judge, I've been before you a lot more than she has. He said, sir, that's not in your favor. Listen to what she's trying to tell you. He constantly interrupted the entire time. Something on the inside said, no, listen, I've got to say something. I've got to do something. You know what? Sometimes we don't get close to Jesus because we've got some conflict in it. You know, let me tell you something. The only thing that can solve that is this.
Right.
When you get to the book of Proverbs and places like that, you need to let it speak to your heart about maybe being rash in judgments. Maybe about being impatient in character. Impatient in character. Maybe about even being agitated in spirit. You walk around with agitation of spirit. You get to the book of Proverbs, and when it points those things out that's going on the inside, you know what that is? It's a way for you to say, Lord, I've got to overcome this because they're keeping me from seeing you for who you really are. And by the way, every time he gives us a victory over one of these areas, we get to see Jesus better than we've ever seen before. Amen?
Amen.
And it's all the way through our life that we keep overcoming problems, difficulties, weaknesses,
yes,
sins,
yes, Lord,
that hide Jesus from appearing to us how he wants to appear for us. Amen?
Amen.
We'll get to some of the other points later because I don't think y'all want to go to 1 o'clock today.
So the truth is, you can see Jesus.
Yes.
Aren't you glad he found the tree?
Yes.
Listen, you know what he had to do? He had to humble himself. Listen, an older gentleman. He's wealthy. If they were mocking him before, can you imagine what they're saying now?
Right.
You're so small, you got to climb up in a tree. I mean, I could have all the ridicule, right? He had to humble himself to get up that tree so that he could see someone, listen, that would change his life forever.
Amen.
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 Amen. That's the first step, getting closer to Jesus, by the way. Saying, Lord, I need you. If you're here this morning, you're not saved. Can I plead with you to come to Christ?
Amen.
Hell is forever and ever and ever and ever. Listen to me. There are no exit signs in hell. Once you go there, you'll be there. The only hope you have of getting out of that judgment is by putting your faith and trust in Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And Christian, Jesus loves you. He does. He wants a closer walk with you. Why don't you come this morning saying, Lord, that's what I desire too. And if there's anything in my life that's not letting me see you like I should see you, Lord, show me how to overcome that. Teach me how to be a better Christian. Clear up my vision that I could see Christ. Would you do that this morning? Let's stand for prayer. Father, we thank you for this day.